So I would like you to, this is called the pressure bar here, and I'd like you to notice the difference right here with the strings. This is called the speaking wave. This is where the sound that the hammer hits and this part vibrates. We have introduced a little notch right here where the pressure bar starts, and this is the metal case that can be exchanged. It's made out of steel and brass alloy. Why did we do that? Well, first of all, I'm going to show you the, and I have to tell you this is not the right picture, because this one is an HU5. I'm going to show you the HU1. You see, the HU1 does not have that. It has just the iron cast frame that has been prepared. So it touches, the skin touches directly the frame. In the HU5, and I apologize, this is incorrect, but I'm not using it correct. There is this steel insert. Why? Over time, and with heavy play especially, these strings move just that little. They will create grooves into the panel. These grooves will be different from note to note, and they will make the piano sound not as professional as cohesive. So we're talking about, you know, 5 years, 10 years of play. What you then have to do is, you'd have, not many people can do it in the United States, you'd have to take the strings off, you know, create again, go over it with the device, make sure it's again even, and then start over. And over time, if you do it one or two times, you lose the height, you lose down bearing, so people don't do it. The piano cannot be rebuilt that way. Where with the HU5, once this happens, all you do is you take this insert out, put a new insert in, and you have a new piano. Why was it important? Because we felt, so we needed to provide value to customers. We needed to make sure that a customer can rebuild it, can sell, buy a piano, right? Use it for 10 years, and then when they pass it down to grandma, or to grandma, when grandma passes it down to, they can say, no, this is still a piano that will bring you joy. You just need to do this and this and this, and I'll show you the other thises of the process. So we believe that 50 years from now, grandma will get the pass on the piano, and if they're up and interested, they can renew the piano and have absolutely stunning new piano at almost no cost. So they would have to exchange these parts here, the strings, and we want the next part. Oh, here we go. Do you see better? HU5, you see that insert a little clearer and bigger here. Since we're at that point, let me fast forward to the other part. The other part that's important in longevity for pianos is the key bit. So the key bit holds the action that goes and allows you to play. Most key bits are made of wood. Actually, all keybeds are made of wood, except ours. Over time, keybeds start to sag. Just natural how this goes. Playing, weight, the natural gravity will make them sag. So they will move down a couple of millimeters, and what will happen is the entire action geometry will shift a little bit along. So often you have played a piano where the bass is maybe heavy, the treble feels really light, but with a middle section and you know, like, okay, I'll adapt to it, right? But a good piano should be even all across. So we have our keybeds are just the aluminum alloy that doesn't change. We always stay the same, and you can go down downstairs and look at it. And so in 30 years or 20 years or 10 years, when grandma passes or, you know, pass on the piano, all you have to do is take the action, the action out, and put a new action in, and you have a new piano. Sounds that plays exactly, has a wonderful touch, and no compromise there. And so for us, those are important points that allow a customer to feel confident in an investment. This is going to spend $7,000 to $20,000. And we want them to know that this will last, and will last longer than anything else that is currently out there. Another feature of our instruments that are found in pianos that cost three times more are 8 grafts in the base section. So Remember, I had a picture where we went to put a spring like over the iron cat's frame. So many people have done iron manufacturers. European manufacturers always put egress in, and what it does, it allows the exact length of the design of the kennel intended for the kennel to have to be achieved. So it's not guessing, no. Once we put it in, we twist exactly the angle, and the length of the string, the speaking length of the string, is exactly, it matches what the designer wanted. Before, you had, you know, some kennels matched it, some strings didn't match it, so you had to play around a little bit. For us, that was a good thing. And you'll find that European instruments that cost much more than ours. And ours have that standardized and ours are modified and so on. I hope what I'm trying to do is overwhelm you with technical things, but I want to create a little bit of appreciation of the little details. Looking at your piano, a piano, right? And because they all look black and the same. And it's the little details that, you know, make the difference in price. We make our own action with Mr. Chen's backing and Dr. Chen's. We discuss the kind of action stability that echoes the keybed. Let's see what. Hammers used here. So the soundboard, strings, and the hammers, those three components create the magic, right? We use hammers, and I'd like to give you a little bit of an idea here how this evolved. So with the piano exploding around the 19th century, it became difficult to find high-grade felt. You had to find sheep. You had to shear them. You had not all the felt, you know, that the sheep gave you were the right thing. So, you know, you had to have a huge, you know, mountains of wool to get what you need for the camp. So many manufacturers or the industry moved to trying to, you know, increase it, right? Treating those with heavy chemicals. So you take even subpar wool and just kill it with chemicals. And then what we would do is, because, you know, the fine felt is easily moldable, the larger ones are, you know, they're more resistant. So they would put lots of heat, chemicals before, lots of heat to create those chemicals. So what we did is we went back and sourced our felt from Australia, and were able to find a supplier and started cold pressing our hammers. And so for at this moment, we ship all that is purchased by Mr. Jack Wurz, who is a German, and goes to his factory in Germany. And he ships those cold pressed hammers with a cold pressed felt to us, and we cold press the felt on the hammer, which should allow the technician to have a much easier way of voicing the instrument. You don't have to put it in. So that has been, and I have to say, that has been our way. It's not anymore for anything that doesn't come in the United States, so we have reserved those. In China, they have, because of volume has increased, they're using different felt. So there's differences in the products where they go to. Do you have any questions, thoughts at this moment? Is this too technical, or is this still interesting? If you have questions, please don't hesitate. So, with the uprights, they are CNC machines, cut the wood, and they even put in the notches on the bridge. So the notches are. Where the pins, the bridge pins go in. This is all, for all our uprights, is done with pure control. Why? Well, our biggest issue has always been growth. So going to go from 3,500 kilos to 40,000 kilos right now. And keep in mind that the United States is currently, I mentioned the number 9,000 units back in 2006, about 33 this time. China is consuming 300,000 pounds a year in domestic market, primarily upland. It's a huge culture around the piano, a huge culture. You are not a human being in China if you don't have a piano to play the piano in the palace. It's incredible. And so we have probably probably 10,000 to reach our production in the factory. But all these uplines are going to go primarily to the Chinese market. And yeah, it's a huge, huge market. So these are all produced that way. Here you can see a key and how it's weighted. And you can see that our instruments, uplines, are heavily sharp. So now for plastic wear, they're stripped with all the edges, which is a nice little touch. Here we're into a little bit more of technical details about reeling. I'm going to skip on the worst parts and try to pick up a little bit more interesting parts. Let's see. So I explained to you how our philosophy was to bring a sound that is not piercing, it's warm, powerful, but which are other tones. And how you do that, how you create these other tones, and this goes back to an American company that invented this, is by utilizing a technology of scale. Steinway invented, Steinway owners invented the Dupont scale back in the 19th century, and it quickly became kind of a hallmark of Casper Cross. What's the Dupont scale? Duplex, two chambers, two rooms, right? So I told you about the speaking length, everybody relates to a speaking length. So in the duplex scaling strategy, from, let's say, here's the key that the hammer touches, right? And here's the bridge. This would be the dead part, usually, from here, from the bridge to where the string is attached. Well, the duplex idea was to make this part sympathetic. It is also able to sing or hum along, if you will. So the duplex scale is the idea that this non-speaking part here, non-speaking because there is no hammer that hits it, also has the ability to speak a little bit in overtones. And so the HU5, for instance, and the HU7 are an upright, have a duplex scale. That is, they have two chambers, the non-speaking, the speaking chamber or the part, the non-speaking. And that creates those overtones that are a hallmark of this warmer Western sound. So you'll find that at the HU5. And this is the end of the duplex scaling. You see a little detail is that the HU5 pitch pins have what we call double stringing, so the string goes down and around. However, if you go further, the HU7 has single stringing. Each string ends up in its own position. And it has what we call an acutune bar at the end again, the same principle I showed you exactly. Again, little details that make the piano worthwhile. I am going to jump forward. Oh, here is a good picture of the duplex. Speaking length, right? Here would be the non-speaking length. So I'm going to jump now over to the grand piano so you can get a feel for that. So the first part is, again, repeats a little bit what we have discussed in the upright section. The agenda of those parts that are redundant, so we've implemented similar principles in the upright and the grand and upright. Sense agraphs as well again. So we have problem 1 point, move here to something that is. So you see, you saw the picture of the upright that had been launched by the machine, that's the CNC machine. Well, you can do it with grand cameras. Grand cameras use tender level care. Simply because they have a bigger area, there's more wood. You need to make sure the wood is the right places. So everything that's print camel or everything that is wood related with the camel is done by a craftsman factory. So you can see here he is using tools to notch them. And you can imagine these in all the factories that are probably. These are really high peak positions, because if he makes a mistake, the entire soundboard has to be, you know, if you can save it, they will, but if not, then they have to throw it away. So we might need to have a better chance of letting that goes down. Our grand cameras have solid maple, bridge cap. This is right here. Well, why is that important? Well, you want the bridge to be hardwood, so the energy stays in the string and is not given on to the wood. If it's given, it should be given an entire thing to make the soundboard resonate. If it's soft, the softness will kind of dampen the string. So European manufacturers always have a cap on top of a hardwood cap, and so do we. Then the other thing is that we had civil, well, we always felt that the piano industry is a very male-dominated industry. Many technicians are male, and so we felt that we need to do something about two things. About 50%, other 50% of the collection of this world, and then those of us who have families. And if you have ever used, truly, a grand piano is not female-friendly, you know. If you're a woman and you have to lift that lid up, it's a chore. And if you're a pianist and you start practicing at school and your core, you're on one level, you have to, you know, make sure you know, get that up. And many will not. Many will just leave it open or halfway. And so that was a big issue. Then in churches, you know, you have often enough pianists who are, not anymore under Schwarzenegger physique, right? And they have to go up there and change the piano or do one thing or the other. So that was an issue. And then we had families with kids. So in the last 5 years, there's, I know, 3 cases of kids or individuals who have either broken the wrist or fingered from the catalytic coming back. And so we picked up an idea. We picked up on an idea, and are the only ones who are have kids that are family friendly, as I say, or female friendly. So we created this box called the help system, which essentially forces all the pressure of the weight into this box here. It does impact the rim because the forces are vertical, they're pushed out, and it has 2 cylinders in here. And it'll allow the piano to be lifted with the finger. And more importantly, if you drop the lid, you can put your hand on it. It just comes down gently and touches it. And we have had people who purchased and traded in pianos that they just bought just for that feature. Because they felt that was a big part. So you have to think outside the box to bring solutions that are working. Well, in summary, we have been, many things have happened. Brigham bought this building, moved to a big store. The Hailun factory was publicly listed 1.5 years ago. Chinese stock exchange, one of four, one of five companies that I'm aware of listed. Well, actually, one of four. Diamond was delisted recently, but are publicly traded. We have become from a small boutique place to a bigger place. We're right now the third biggest factory in China. But most likely we will stop growing. We feel that we will stay at the size we have, just to make sure that we can continue catering to those priorities, making instruments to our liking. There's others who make 100,000 instruments, and there is a difference when we go to those scales. For grand cameras, we produce approximately 3,000 grand cameras, which a third is the license. So, import markets. And the rest goes to China. Primarily, there's others, but the US is the biggest market inside China. And in 2012, we garnered the award as piano line of the year, which we're very proud of. And 2013, we're given, January this year, we're given the award for being piano line 2013. What that means, I'd like to qualify that. That doesn't mean that we're the best piano. Because I'd like to use it that way, but it's not, to be honest. It means that the dealers that, or a broad amount range of dealers to vote us as their favorite piano. So favorite probably correlates to well-performing issues, customer satisfaction, but it's a subjective statement. It's not really but we're obviously very glad about it. And what is the future of the piano and what is our future? Of course, we're true to Christopher's dreams. And we're continuing on several projects that have to do with Christopher. But we're working very hard on merging the worlds of digital and Christopher in meaningful ways. And there's others who are starting doing that. And we will do more additional solutions.